Here practicing bhakti yoga, the yoga of love and devotion. And in bhakti, our aim is to remember the divine as much as possible, to awaken the conscious awareness of the divinity within. Really, it is the sacred waking up within us, looking out through our eyes, knowing itself as divine love, and knowing all perceived others as that too. So all of the practices of bhakti are meant to help us remember who we truly are, so that we may embody it and bring that love into the world in service. Remembering the God within, remembering the God in the world that is everything, and then serving the world because the world is God. And if the word God isn't the most resonant word for you, maybe it's spirit or consciousness or source or true nature. We are chanting this evening, we'll be chanting the holy names of the divine. We'll also be chanting in English. But all of the holy names, the deity names that we chant to, are just all pointers to our own inner divinity. They are meant to awaken our own inner divinity just by chanting them. The mantras work on us all on their own. So we don't even really have to understand what we're saying exactly. That's all helpful, but it's just the practice itself that clears the mind and creates space for our own inner divinity to come to the fore. So we're going to start with just chanting some ohms and kind of doing a few things to kind of help open our voices. And so we're going to be singing a lot, and it's common sometimes for people to hold tension in their jaw and their face and their neck when they're singing, especially if we're singing for a long time. So just taking some awareness, maybe even bring your hands to your jaw, just kind of massaging your jaw along the jawline, massaging the neck, opening the jaw, moving it from side to side. And let's just do some sighs together. Ah. 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 Maybe you take your sigh a little bit higher. Just an exhale, it's just a sighing exhale. So to just keep that in mind as we're singing this evening, especially if you start to feel tension or discomfort, to come back to that, ah, that relaxation. And so let's do three ohms together. Take in a deep inhale. Sighing exhale. Good. Inhale. Take your own to a different note if you like. So you could continue with the ohms or any other vowel sound that you'd like, e's or ahs or oos. Actually, the ah vowel is associated with the heart chakra, if you want to use the ah. But as you're singing, just to like focusing on that space of the heart and maybe asking what wants to come from that space. Or maybe even sending your voice to that space of the heart and just really listening to that space, seeing how using the heart as an informant of sorts, like a channel for how your voice wants to move just in these next few moments. Thank you. do one big om together. Inhale. I'm going to start with the Hanuman Chalisa. So I see lots of familiar faces and also lots of new faces, which is wonderful. Love always having a mix of both of those things. The Hanuman Chalisa is the wordiest thing that we will chant this evening, so don't let it scare you away. It is a 40-verse prayer in an ancient pre-Hindu language called Aladi, and it is basically describing, praising, remembering the deity Hanuman, who is up here on our altar. He's the monkey deity. And so Hanuman symbolizes devotion to truth. He's pulling his chest open. He has Ram and Sita in his heart. Ram represents the formless, the absolute, true consciousness, pure consciousness. Sita represents form, manifestation, creation. And so the coming together of both of these, we are 100% divine and 100% human. And so, how do we awaken to our divinity and then really embody it and honor our humanness as well, and stay really true to that path. So I love Hanuman because he's kind of like this innocent, sort of like doesn't always know what he's doing, but he has this pure heart and service to the divine. And so whenever I feel like I don't know what I'm doing either, which is most of the time, I love that Hanuman is like this really comforting deity of like, ah, it's okay. Like, I know I'm doing my best. I'm doing my best. Come back to our own sincerity. Just keep trying, keep showing up. All right, so we're gonna chant this prayer. You can follow along on your handout. If it's a little too overwhelming, you can just read along or just listen. But we do sing Shri Ram, JJ Ram, which is just victory to Ram. We sing that a few times. That's an easy time to join in. Shri Ram, JJ Ram. Shri Ram, JJ Ram.
Shri Ram, JJ Ram. Shri Ram.
Thank you.
it's too bright. Well, that was beautiful, everyone. So we're going to do the Maha Mantra. We're actually doing a lot of Maha Mantra today. So if you're not familiar with the Maha Mantra, you will be when you leave. So the Maha Mantra is also known as the Hare Krishna Mantra. And it's the Maha means great, so it's known as the Great Mantra. So some bhakti practitioners, I mean, bhakti, just like any spiritual path or religion, has, you know, many different flavors, right? So bhakti is not different. It's huge. And there's kind of the Hare Krishna camp of bhaktis, which is like they only chant the Hare Krishna mantra. Like that's all they chant. They don't chant anything else. The lineage that I most strongly identify with is the lineage of Neem Karoli Baba, who's up on the altar here in the round frame. But his lineage has Ram Das, who is Ram Das's guru, and Krishna Das, and Nina Rao, and Jayutal, a lot of these Westerners that went over to India and met him, and then they kind of brought this practice back to us and made it accessible for us, essentially put it in language that we can understand in our culture. So, and in Neem Karoli Baba, also known as Maharaji, in his temple, Hanuman is the main deity that is worshiped. So they do a lot of Hanuman, a lot of Ram and Sita chanting, but they also do the Maha Mantra too. And Maharaji said it's all the same essentially, but yeah, so we're gonna do the Hare Krishna mantra, and this is call and response, which means that I'll sing the mantra and then you all will repeat. And up here we have Charles Mitchell on keys, who's also singing responses. Also, we have Cole and Tiffany, who are singing responses today. Gabriella and Thomas obviously are not here, and so these two stepped in. They are very devoted members of this community, as many of you know, and so it's a real treat to be able to bring other people up here to help us leave. So thank you all for being here today. And I'll just, I'll finish introducing everyone since I'm sometimes bad about that and I'm doing it, so I'll go ahead and do it. This is my husband, Barry, on the electric guitar. He also does all the sound equipment, and he is like my own personal Hanuman devoted to me, which is why this is able to happen at all. So you can thank him later. This is Ben Short on bass. He's also a wonderful yoga teacher and has some of his own amazing music in Lightning. You should check them out. And this is Charles Bingham on percussion. He's also been playing. Barry and I started playing together we were playing other things together, but about 8 years ago, we started doing Kirtan together. And it was just me and the harmonium and Barry and the djembe and in like a church room with like two people. And shortly after, we brought it to Yoga East, and Charles Bingham caught wind of it, and he's been playing with us ever since. So he's been with us a long time, as has Charles Mitchell. Ben is newer, but not also, because you've been around a long time too. So anyway, okay, that's our story. We're Anahata Bhakti.
Yeah.
So we're going to do the Hare Krishna. So I was saying all that to say, I don't even think I said this part. If you're not sure when to sing, the response singers are Tiffany, Cole, and Charles. And so when they're singing, that's like when you sing. Well, Brandon just got here. Brandon introduced this song to us that we're gonna do next. So, Hare Krishna.
Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama.
Your turn.
Hare Krishna.
Chanting has, just like any other kind of meditation practice, right? We're focusing on the mantra, on the singing, so that becomes like our anchor to the present moment, and everything else kind of falls away. And so just resting in that space, that quiet space when the mantra falls away. I heard a meditation teacher refer to mantra as an on-ramp for true meditation, meaning it's sort of like what gets you to that space of openness, of just pure being, and then we rest there. It's kind of a long on-ramp, but it has its joy too. All right, we're gonna do Across the Universe. Charles is gonna lead it. This is a real treat. So we change the chorus on this, so there, yeah, I'm sorry, I'm one of your many sheets. I usually make like a custom handout each time, and I just didn't this time because it's time consuming, so you have four sheets, but we change the chorus, so it's just Jaya Guru Deva Om, and that just means victory to the inner teacher, victory to the inner guru. We weren't exactly sure what John Lennon was talking about. I did a little bit of Googling. I don't know. There's like kind of a weird story about some of this song. He was like mad at his wife or something. Anyway.
That's okay. It's the energy that we put into it.
Right, exactly. So we're infusing
what we think about it. How we think.
We're infusing this with a little more like pure bhakti spirit. This is just join in.
Who's the Supreme with us.
That's right. That's right. We used to
call that
beep tea.
Wow.
Charles, you're like, how can you not have a thing like Charles? Okay, so I'm going to read a little excerpt from this book that I just started reading. It's called Wild Mercy by Mirabai Starr. Probably some of you have heard of her. But actually, she her gurus were also Maharaji and Siddhi Ma, who was sort of the teacher that took over Maharaji when he left his body, and she left her body a few years ago. But anyway, I picked it up. I've heard of Mirabai Starr forever. I've seen this book. I thought it looked awesome. I picked it up in the bookstore the other day and literally opened to this passage that I'm about to read you, and was just so moved by it because she really speaks to bhakti and non-dualism, which is just such an interesting point of contemplation for me and has been all along my journey. Because when we think about devotion, and you know, devotion is being devoted to something, right? Or being devoted to the divine. So often, it can be often thought of as dualistic, like we are channeling our devotion outward, you know, to some kind of divine source that is outside of us. And so even when I started singing kirtan years ago, I was very kind of zen and non-dual in my practice. And it kind of took me a while to sort of be like, what's going on here? Like, does this actually align with my own kind of the way I'm hooked up, you know, to connect with the divine, or do I just like singing songs? So I love, you know, along my journey, and I know a lot of you have heard me speak about this before, but along my journey, like getting deeper into the bhakti teachings and just discovering, and actually the lineage of Maharaji is very much rooted in non-dualism, that everything is love, everything is one. All of the mantras that we chant are all essentially evoking our own true nature, this same divine love that we all share. And so I love any kind of like text or contemplation that brings together devotion and non-dualism, because it's like, well, there's, you know, the devotee and the divine, so that it's two things, right? But it doesn't really, like for me, I didn't really feel like that. It didn't really feel like I was singing to something outside of myself. So anyway, this is not a super long passage. It's like a page and a half. But I just think that this speaks to it so beautifully about, yeah, devotion and bhakti and non-dualism and how those work together. Miranda, this is a friend of hers that she's writing about. Miranda had a spontaneous awakening while sitting in the cave of the 20th century's great teacher of Advaita Vedanta, also known as non-dualism, Ramana Maharshi, in India. At that point, she had already spent years leading groups in contemplative practices. She was a spiritual director, directing other spiritual directors. Her specialty was interspiritual devotional practices, such as guided visualizations and chanting, and she drew on wisdom teachings from all the world's great traditions. The core element of Miranda's approach was prayer, or devotion, and the various methods of praising the One, with a capital O, filled her heart and affected her students in a similarly uplifting way. It was hard to avoid getting hooked on these sweet encounters with the reality of love. But the reliably overflowing spirit vessel emptied out that day in the cave. Miranda heard Ramana's voice, though he had left his body decades earlier. Quote, "Be still," he said. "Be nothing. Do nothing. Get nothing. Become nothing. Relinquish nothing. Rest in God." In that moment, without hesitation, Miranda surrendered. She released the rich content of her spiritual life and let go of the sublime teachings she had studied. As she stepped into the non-dual void, all those years of meditating and praying, of chanting and visualizing fell away, and Miranda plunged into the heart of the mystery. Perfect sound effect. This unsettling descent into spiritual and conceptual groundlessness continued to unfold for many months, and her former life unraveled with it. She left the center she had founded in London and entered a period of relative seclusion in California. Then one day, while Miranda was running in the woods, a Hindu chant bubbled up from the ground of her being and emerged in song, Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Om. This flow of sacred song took Miranda by surprise. She had not sung devotional music in many months. She had become incapable of engaging in the dualistic practices that had formerly been so central to her life. But now the love energy was flowing freely into the hollowed out space of her soul. My heart felt as if it had just exploded with light and love and ecstatic praise, Miranda told me. In that moment, I realized that it was that, with a capital T, praising that, capital T, in my heart. As the Sufis say, it is the beloved's own love that loves the beloved in me. This was the day that prayer, devotion, and chanting returned to my life, but not as a method to get anywhere. Rather, Miranda describes this upwelling of adoration as a natural recirculation of that nectar of grace, which is our true nature. When we sing sacred music, we sit beneath a rushing fountain of love that washes over us and leaves us in a state of holy hush. Ecstasy empties into stillness. The holy praises herself and grows silent. Into that silence, we may fall and fall forever. Gate, gate, paragate, parasangate, bodhisattva. This is the great Buddhist blessing at the end of the Heart Sutra, known as the Prajna Paramita, which is the embodiment of the divine feminine, by the way. Gone, gone, gone beyond. Gone beyond the beyond, all hail to the one who goes. Sometimes I am tempted to add more commentary to that which does not need commentary, so we're just going to chant some more. So we'll do, we're going to do the Hridaya Maha Mantra. So this one on your many pages. On one of the pages that says mantras, there are two, there is a number 5 that starts with, in my heart, that is the one that we're doing next. So this one has English and it also has the Maha Mantra in it. The Maha Mantra is call and response and the English is chanted all together. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare,
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna.
Thank you, everyone, for chanting with me and with us. It's the best. You all are awesome. All right, I'm going to turn it over to Charles again. We're going to do his Hey Ma. So this one is on one of the handouts. I think it has its own. Yeah, it's actually.
Yeah.
Hey Ma, J Ma.
Y'all can just join in however you feel.
Ma is the divine mother. Hey, yes. We're saying hey to her.
Hey, ma, ma, ma.
Hey.
Thank you, Charles. Thank you. So we're going to do one more. I know it's always so sad. So just wanted to kind of let you all know when we're playing next. We're not going to have the May Kirtan here. It's Derby weekend. And we also are doing a couple of festivals. So it's festival season. There's a lot of that going on. It's a lot. It's a lot to make this happen every month. So when we're doing festivals, you know, we kind of, for the sake of my family, try to pare it down a little bit. That being said, too, we really appreciate your donations. We have a $20 suggested donation. And if that's not possible for you, anything that you can offer us, if you want to offer us more, this is really a labor of love. There's a lot of work and heart that goes into it, a lot of people that come together to make it happen. The money also goes to support the space, the Inner Warrior, which is such a beautiful space. So, and then other things that you can do, you know, to contribute instead of donations, like I always love if people bring flowers or other altar items for the altar. And then also, if you hang around and socialize, we like to hang around and socialize for a while after. And if you happen to still be here when we're loading all of our equipment back down the Inner Warrior stairs and you want to help carry it, that would be amazing. Just dropping that in. But
stay and hang out with us.
In February, we had like a crew of folks that helped us carry. I say us, I'm usually still socializing, it's very difficult. But yeah, it was amazing. It was like a crew of people helping us do that. And we were like, oh. So the next time that we're playing is Friday, April 26th, and it's at Buck Creek Sanctuary in Elizabeth. Is it Elizabeth Town or Elizabeth?
Elizabeth.
Elizabeth, Indiana. Thank you. Yeah.
Elizabeth.
Okay. Right. So actually, Ken is back here. Ken is the owner of Buck Creek Sanctuary in Elizabeth, Indiana. It's a beautiful, beautiful, magical place, you all. It's so special. And he and two other people, Logan McNeil and Charles's wife, Julia, have created this community vision called We Are Growing Home. And it's just this beautiful vision of community that they're creating. And so they're having an event in celebration of Beltane. It's going to be April 26th, 27th, and 28th.
Yeah.
You can buy tickets for it, you can camp, but it's going to have all kinds of like workshops, different yoga and wellness workshops. I don't know, Charles, you might be able to say more about it.
Yeah, I can speak a little bit about it. You know, the vision is to bring together a lot of the things that we love that our community offers, and also kind of trying to revive traditional community activities whose specific purpose was to like help bond us together as like a group of people. So these rituals were not just like, oh, springtime, like the seasons and stuff, and we're farmers. Like, it was really to like remind everyone of our, you know, united human nature and our communities. So Beltane is in a sense a revival of that effort and an opportunity to get to know some of the awesome teachers and people who like hold space and engage in artistic activities. And there's gonna be a kids area and food and all sorts of stuff. It's meant to be, you know, not as much of an event, it's more like a big family reunion for like our, you know, for us, you know. So I mean, yeah, kind of like that, you know.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah. And I also want to add too that, you know, there are tickets to purchase, but there's work trade
opportunities.
Plenty of that where you can get discounts on ticket prices. So anyway, we'll be offering Kirtan Friday night as part of that gathering. We're really excited about it. And then we'll be at My Path Fest, My Path to Flow, which is like June 2nd, third, fourth.
May 30th to June 2nd.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
I looked at the flyer before.
Okay. May 30th to June 2nd, we'll be doing Kirtan on the Sunday of that event. And Barry and I will be doing one of our ethereal music and satsang guided meditation things too on the Saturday morning, My Path to Flow. So anyway, so we'll be doing those two events, and then we'll be back here in July for the community Kirtan. So that's when you can catch us next. Again, thank you all so much for coming. It's so good to be with all of you. We're gonna close with Sacred Rivers.
Information online?
Oh, yeah, yes. Barbara, I can connect up with you and yeah, send you info for stuff. Yeah.
Breathing, breaking, open wide.
I know a lot of you already know this, but I wrote that song out of my love for this community. One night, alone, by the fire out in my backyard. And I was just, I just felt so much love for all of you. And it just like, it was like having a feeling and trying to match a song to the feeling. And I feel like this song does that. And then to have all of you singing it together, now that we've done it a few times and people know it, it's just like, oh my God. Almost too much for me to bear. It's so beautiful. Thank you all so much for singing it with me. So beautiful.
We love you too.
Oh, let's bring hands to heart center. Just acknowledging the precious gift of having all the privileges that we have, where we can be here together. Gratitude that we have all of our other needs met to a degree enough that allows for us to really practice and to delve into these questions of the mystery of our being together in community. Such a gift to be able to do that together. Gratitude to each of you for coming, for this confluence of sacred rivers coming together, and gratitude to all of the teachers, the people and places and cultures that have brought us these beautiful practices. Deepest bows, thank you all so much for being here.
Thank you, Emily.
stick around and hang out. Woo, the party's not over yet.
There's also blessed bananas up here that Cole brought. Please help yourself to a banana.